Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. Hi, I'm Sandra Weston, and it's my pleasure to support our church family in this portion of our Bible study as we continue our study on the Baptist covenant. Our pastor asked me to address a portion of the covenant, so I'm delighted to do so. So, with that, let's get into it. Let's have a word of prayer first. Father God, we thank you for this opportunity. We thank you for this day. We thank you, Lord, to come before you in corporate study once again. We pray, oh Lord God, that you will bless everything that's said and done here and help us to live better as we live in service for you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, so over the last few weeks, we've been talking about the Baptist covenant. And as Pastor mentioned, this is a subject that I don't think I've heard mentioned or discussed in Bible study before. It was just kind of something that we grew up saying as a congregation with our pastoral exchange on Communion Sundays. And truthfully, I can probably recite most of the portions without a script because I've recited it so many times over the years. But I don't know if I've ever seriously considered it as a covenant or as a vocalized promise. Much like the old responsive readings, remember those we used to do in church? It was just something we did. But I've grown to see the covenant in a different light. I'm going to read my portion in its entirety, and then I will break it down section by section. My section starts, "We further engage to watch over one another in brotherly love, to remember each other in prayer, to aid one another in sickness and distress, to cultivate Christian sympathy in feeling and Christian courtesy in speech, to be slow to take offense, but always ready for reconciliation and mindful of the rules of our Savior to secure it without delay." So let's start in the beginning. The section starts with, "We further engage to watch over one another in brotherly love." The scripture reference here is Romans 12:10. And it tells us to be kindly affectioned to one another with brotherly love. Well, how are we supposed to do this? Well, we have to first acknowledge that we are our brother's keeper, our sister's keeper, and they are our extended family. We should be loving toward each other. We should care about our fellow brothers and sisters, same as our blood brothers and sisters. We should be earnest in greeting and showing kindness toward one another, even when they're very different from you. We tend to associate with people who are a lot like us, but sometimes we should get to know somebody that may be a little different. We should honor one another above ourselves, and we should take delight in honoring each other. The next clause of the section says that we should remember each other in prayer, and that's referenced in Ephesians 6:18 and 1 Thessalonians 5:25. It tells us that we should pray for each other. God gives us the gift of prayer. We should use it, and we should use it for good. We should consider it a privilege to pray for others. I know we know how to pray for ourselves, but it's more of a sacrifice to pray for someone else. It takes thought, it takes care, and it takes empathy to pray for others. We should be paying attention to each other. So we notice something going on with somebody, we should pray about it. It's never wrong to pray for somebody else. We should note things that people say to us so we can pray for them. Even if they don't ask you to pray, you should pray for them as you would your own family, because after all, we are extended family. The next clause of the covenant says to aid one another in sickness and distress. And the scripture reference is Galatians 6:10. The New Living Translation tells us, therefore, whenever we have the opportunity, we should do good to everyone, especially those in the family of faith. That's kind of self-explanatory. When others are sick, we should visit them. We should visit them if we're permitted to visit them, or if it's not too tiresome for the individual. We can run errands. We can offer to assist, maybe drive a child somewhere or something. We can cook food or order food. We should do things that love them. When others are in distress, we should do what you can to relieve their situation, because we are God's hands here on earth. I would ask, though, to be sure that you're being led by the Spirit of God. You don't want to force yourself on anyone, and you don't want to do it with the wrong intentions. I believe that when God exposes a situation to you, you have an obligation to do what you can. So someone may say something to you that they may not say to anybody else, but we have an obligation to try to be God's hands here on earth to help our brothers and sisters. The next section says we need to cultivate Christian sympathy and feeling. Now, to cultivate something means to improve or develop by careful attention, training, or study. To devote time and thought to. A scripture reference here is 1 Corinthians 12, 25-26, where it says in a New Living Translation, "This makes harmony among the members so that all members care for each other. If one part suffers, all the parts suffer with it. And if one part is honored, all parts are glad." That means we have to work on it. It doesn't always come easily to us to cultivate something. It doesn't always come easily to us to experience Christian sympathy and feeling, which means we have to work on it. We have to cultivate it. We should make the effort to always show kindness. Sometimes it's easier said than done, but always lead with kindness. We should lead with heart. Try to feel others' pain, struggles, or distress. Empathy is the word. And empathy is the ability to understand and share the feelings of another. But also, we should feel each other's joys and victories and triumphs. No jealousy or hate, because God is no respecter of person. What He does for somebody else, He can do for you. So we don't have any reason to be jealous or hate about other people's successes. We should be happy for each other in successes. And as part of the Christian body, your success is my success. We should remember the times when we were stressed and try to treat others as you would want to be treated. Christian sympathy and feeling doesn't mean you just say the right thing. It means you also feel the right thing. Try to put yourself in someone else's shoes. Our next session talks about courtesy and speech. And this ties directly to the previous clause of cultivating Christian sympathy and feeling. Because we do want to exercise empathy, but we also want to say the right things. And more importantly, not say the wrong things. Courtesy in speech is something we should all live by. Over the last 4 or 5 years in our country, courtesy in speech has been missing at the highest level of leadership. And it seems to have trickled down in our society. But as Christians, we're held to a covenant, a higher standing. We cannot be lulled into the newfound comfort of this behavior. We have a responsibility to be lights in this world. So even when others may not be kind to you in their speech, you should try to be kind to them. The scripture reference here is Titus 3, where it says in the New Living Translation, "They must not slander anyone and must avoid quarreling. Instead, they should be gentle and show true humility to everyone." In addition, Proverbs 15:1 tells us, "A soft answer turneth away wrath, but grievous words stir up anger." The New Living Translation says it another way. It says, "A gentle answer deflects anger, but harsh words make tempers flare." Again, lead with kindness, even if it's not extended to you. Again, easier said than done, but we have a covenant that we're agreeing to that we'll do so. Courtesy in speech is not just critical to us at church, but in our homes, in our jobs, and in our daily lives. Remember that once those words are out, you can't put that toothpaste back in the tube. Even if you apologize and are forgiven, unkind words are hard to forget. Unkind words or not being courteous in speech has turned people away from church and families. Friendships have been broken. because of them. And we can do so much harm with words. We need to be careful with how we use them. The tongue is the unruly member of the body. It takes effort to tame the tongue and to ensure it speaks in courtesy toward others. Courtesy of speech, much like Christian sympathy, has to be cultivated. We have to work at it. Practice, practice, practice. Our next statement is we should be slow to take offense. And the scripture reference is Romans 12:19, where in the King James Version it says, "Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine. I will repay, saith the Lord." In a New Living Translation, it says it a bit more plainly. It says, "Dear friends, never take revenge. Leave that to the righteous anger of God. For the scriptures say, I will take revenge. I will pay them back, says the Lord." What this means to us is that things will happen in life that are not fair, and we need not go out of our way to try to make them right. Let God do it. We should try not to be offended in circumstances where it may not be warranted. For instance, someone may be walking on the other side of the church, somebody that you know fairly well, and they don't speak to you on a particular Sunday morning. And you assume it has something to do with you personally. It may not. They could be having a bad day, or their mind could be on something, or they could be looking in your direction right at you, but they didn't really see you. I've been guilty of that. Be slow to take offense. There are times when people may be short because they're preoccupied or something's bothering them or something, they're distracted. It's my experience when someone's trying to offend you, it's not subtle. And even in instances where people may intentionally be offensive, the Bible is telling us that revenge belongs to God. Our Father in heaven sees all and knows all. You don't have to fix the situation yourself. God knows, and He'll take care of it. This is why prayer is our greatest weapon. Pray about it. The Bible teaches us to acknowledge God in all our ways, and He will direct our paths. That's Proverbs 3:6. All means all. The first thing we should do when things go awry is pray. The key here is to be slow to take offense. That don't mean you won't be offended. It means we should be slow to take offense. Be hesitant to assume that you're being wrong. Don't always be ready for a fight. And God has promised to fight our battles. Let Him. The final clause of this section of the covenant says, "But always ready for reconciliation and mindful of the rules of our Savior, to seek it without delay." The key here is that even when we do get into situations that may have been offensive to us, we're to seek a reconciliation as soon as possible. The scripture references here are Matthew 5:23 and 24 and Matthew 15-18. I won't try to lead a specific discussion on those scriptures here. You can read those on your own. But it's critical for us to understand that reconciliation means to come to some agreeable terms with one another. It's one thing to forgive someone, but it's another thing to reconcile things with another person. Forgiveness takes one person. Reconciliation requires at least two. Reconciliation requires boldness because you have to go to another person to try to come to terms on an issue, where you'll need all the fruits of the Spirit. You know, in Galatians 5:22, we have to be patient and kind and loving in reconciliation to ensure it's achieved. The covenant is telling us here to seek reconciliation without delay. Now, I'm going to be a little transparent here. I'm one of those people that can hold a grudge. So if you make me mad, I can hold on to it. Don't judge me. God is still working with me. I'm not a finished product. Pray for me. But in holding grudges, sometimes we hold on to things way longer and we give it time to fester. We don't want to do that. Now, that's not to say that you can't take time to gather your thoughts before you approach a person. Matter of fact, I would always recommend that you do that and try to think things through before you start talking. But we can't use grudges or our anger as a reason to push out reconciliation. We should get to it right away, or as soon as we possibly can. In the covenant, we're promising to ensure peace with one another and not to hold on to misunderstandings, or even hold on when there is no misunderstanding. We must be able to reconcile situations so that we are working as one body in Christ. So this concludes my portion of the covenant. May God bless us and continue to, as we continue to strive to live up to our portion of this responsibility. Good night. God bless.
To God be the glory. We thank God for his blessed word. The prophet Jeremiah declares, "For I, meaning the Lord, know the plans I have for you. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future." This hope that Jeremiah talks about is hope for the believer, because for the believer there is hope beyond the grave. But what about the non-believer? Well, simply put, there is no hope. The Bible says that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and the wages of sin is eternal death. But there is good news. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. So right now, this very moment, you can be guaranteed eternal life through faith in Jesus Christ. This is our call to discipleship, and it is the most important decision you'll ever make in your lifetime. Romans 10:9-10 says that if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you can believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. Right now, wherever you are, won't you pray this prayer with me? Heavenly Father, I come to you admitting that I am a sinner. I choose to turn away from sin, and I ask you to cleanse me of all unrighteousness. I believe that your Son Jesus died on the cross to take away my sins. I also believe that he rose again from the dead so that I may be justified and made righteous through faith in him. I call upon the name of Jesus Christ to be the Savior and Lord of my life. Jesus, I choose to follow you, and I ask that you fill me with the power of the Holy Spirit. I declare that right now I am a born-again child of God. I am free from sin and full of the righteousness of God. I am saved in Jesus' name. Amen. If you prayed that prayer with me, you are saved, and I welcome you to the body of Christ. It is my prayer that you unite with a Bible-teaching, Bible-preaching church so that you may grow in your spiritual journey. Won't you consider uniting with us at Mount Zion Baptist Church? We are a Bible-teaching, a Bible-preaching church where everybody is special. We're not a perfect church. They simply don't exist. But we serve a perfect God. So if you are interested in growing in faith, please consider uniting with us at Mount Zion. Give us a call at 703-979-7411. Or you may also send an email to info@mountzionbaptist.com. That's 703-979-7411, or send us an email at info@mountzionbaptist.com. We would love to have you become a part of the family. To God be the glory. Amen. It's offering time at Mount Zion Baptist Church, and we are excited. The Bible says that God loves a cheerful giver. Here, we don't beg, we don't force, we don't coerce or trick you into giving. We simply ask that you give according to what God has purposed in your heart. Because of our inability to gather to present our offerings in the traditional manner, we invite you to take advantage of the opportunity to give. There are four ways to give at Mount Zion. First, you may give via the Easy Tithe app on your smart device. You may download the app from the Google Store or the App Store to your smart device to give. Second, you may give using the Easy Tithe app by texting to 703-372-9244. Again, that number is 703-372-9244. Third, you may give on our website, www.mountzionbaptist.com, and click on online giving. Click on the Easy Tithe logo to give. Again, that's www.mountzionbaptist.com. Click on online giving and click on the Easy Tithe logo to give online. Finally, you may give by mailing your check or cash to the Mount Zion Baptist Church, P.O. Box 6216, Arlington, Virginia, 22206. That address is the Mount Zion Baptist Church, P.O. Box 6216, Arlington, Virginia, 22206. Whether you choose to give using the Easy Tithe app on your smart device or text your offering to 703-372-9244 using the Easy Tithe app, whether you visit our website at www.mountzionbaptist.com, or if you mail in your offering to the Mount Zion Baptist Church, P.O. Box 6216, Arlington, Virginia, 22206, we thank you in advance for your giving, and we thank you for your generous support, and may God bless you. Let us pray over the offering. Gracious God, it is an honor to give, and we thank you for the privilege to give. Bless the gift and the giver, and we lift up these gifts to be used to advance your kingdom. Teach us, O God, to be good stewards over all that you have blessed us with. In the name of Jesus the Christ, amen and amen. Thank you again for your giving. To God be the glory.